Okay, we begin with the last parak in the Shar Aleph, in the first gate. Right, so we stopped kind of in the middle. So we were discussing last time that he was saying that even though all of the things that he mentioned about the impact that a person has on all of the oilamis and all of the different levels and layers of creation, and that all of them are controlled by the human being, right? But despite all of that, he says, "Mishabo Moshe." This is in the beginning of Perichov Beis. He says, "Mishabo Moshe." Once Moshe came, "Vaharida Laoretz," and he brought the Torah down to the Oretz, to the land. Lo Bashamayim, it's no longer in heaven. It doesn't make a difference what kavonas you know, that you see the whole master plan of creation. You have to do what is written, right? It doesn't make a difference. You're no longer in to rely on your own creativity and your own knowledge, right? So if so he brought an example over here from Chizkiya HaMelech, right? From Chizkiya HaMelech. Chizkiya HaMelech, if you remember, he saw that he's going to have a child named Menashe. He's going to be a big Rasha, and he's going to do terrible things. So he said, "I have a plan to save the world. I'm not gonna procreate. I'm not gonna get married." And as a result, right, so he's sacrificing, he's not going to get married. Why is he doing it? Totally l'shem shamayim, that, listen, he's going to save the world, right? Comes, he gets sick, comes to him, Yeshaya Anovi comes to him and he says, you're gone from this world, you're gone from Olam Haba, you're done. He says, what do you mean? Everything I tried to do, you know, so many schusim, so many things he did during his lifetime, right? None of it's going to help him. Why not? Right? Because of this one thing, you think you know better. You don't know better. You can't meddle in God's plans. Your job is to do what you're supposed to do, right? Kitayim mitzvahs over here. So let's start over here. Kitayim mitzvahs. Let's see if you have. Let me see. Let me show you. Right here, it's kind of strange in the middle of the here. Kitayim mitzvos, right there. Kitayim mitzvos at tachlisam lo nizgalu adayin l'shum adam ba'olam. The true reasons for mitzvos until their very end, they were never revealed to any person in the world. Aflo Moshe Rabbeinu l'shum, even Moshe Rabbeinu had his limitation. Rak lo adam arishon kodem ached adam arishon, before the sin, he had that kind of a level. V'hu hayayin meshumar. This is what we're calling this special wine that is being saved for the future world. Banova mishesh mebereishis, from the sixth day of creation. V'ha'or shemish b'marishin. That's what we also say. That first light, that light of the first day. Shoyu odu marishin tzoyfa umabid boy mesoyfa oilam atzoyfa oilam. He was able to see from the beginning of creation to the end of creation. Meaning, what does that mean? That means that he saw the whole master plan. He saw the whole. Then he understood how everything works out. Because our holy Torah really comes from the loftiest place, from above all of our understandings. How could it be that such a thing would be given to our independent understanding? To change the process and the seder of the times according to our understanding. Right? And just like Yeshayo answered Lechizkiya to Chizkiya, Behade Kavshi de Rachmon Olamalach, in what is hidden by the Torah, by God, what is it your business? Lomalach, why is it, what is it to you? May de mefagat, whatever you were commanded, iboyluch lemeva, that's what you should be doing. May de nicha kamei kutshabrichu, hulu of it. And whatever Hashem wants to do with your, you know, consequences of your actions, that's his business. That's not your business. Right? V'adayin, now he's going to talk an exception. V'adayin, kashoysu nevuah b'Yisrael, in those days when we used to have prophecy, then there was an exception. What was the exception? That the Novi was able to go against the Torah for temporary pressing need. right? He was able to actually break the laws of the Torah for some emergency suspension, so to speak, right? Right, va'avgam la'avar alachas mitzvot Hashem, even to go against the mitzvot of Hashem, kagoy neliyo ba'akarmel. And the classic example of that is Eliyo on the Mount of Hakarmel. Right, we mentioned this last time that he brought karbonas outside of the Beis Hamikdash. Shukiyotz and other similar examples. Amnam ze'atzmai hu me'asher nitzavinu b'Torah Moshe. Even that exception is already commanded to us. We learn this out from the Torah itself. Elov tishmuun. You have to listen to the Navi even in these kind of cases. We have a special commandment to listen to the words of the prophet, even when it goes, if he's commanding you to go against some sort of a mitzvah. Of course, it has to be at a special circumstance for this. And even there, no special exception, and there's no such special exception for Avodah Zarah. Aval, loy chalila lechadesh dover lekovel lidoris. There is no way that you can be mechadesh anything to be kaveya for generations, right? You can't say that from now on, Har HaKarmel is also included in our Avodas Hashem. So now that Eliyahu HaNavi came, and now he brought karbonos in Har HaKarmel, so you can bring karbonos in two places. You can bring it in Beis HaMikdash, and you can bring it in Har HaKarmel. No, only as a special provision, right? Sharei Esther, even look, Esther Amalka, right? Shehoisu achas mishevan neviyah. She was considered one of the seven prophetesses, right? Im kol zeh, still in all, kashashol chol chachomim kisvuni l'doiris, the Gemara says that she sent out a letter to chachomim, and she says kisvuni l'doiris, meaning include the story of Megillas Esther into the canon, right? Into the books of Tanakh. So his shivu, they responded to her. What did they say? Halakasafti loch shalishim. The Gemara says that there are three places that the Torah is going to discuss the destruction of Amalek, the story of Amalek. Okay, right. So because Esther, part of the whole Esther story, right, is the destruction of Haman, who comes from the family of Amalek. So therefore, the Chachamim say we have a tradition that the pasuk really says that only three times the Torah is going to speak about it, right? At Shemot Solo Acher Kach Smach Min HaMikra, they found a special hint in the pasuk that no, four times is also really it's really supposed to be four times, right? So that once they found a connection to the Torah, so they said, okay, we're going to include that. Right, even the candles of Chanukah, right? It's a mitzvah derabbanan. It's not like, again, it's not like Chachamim said this is a new mitzvah deraisa. This is commandment number 614, right? That they can't do. They're not allowed to add on any new commandments. However, they're coming to say no. This is a special commandment derabbanan for the zecher, for the miracle, right? On all of those things. But even then, they also found a remez, a hint, a support from a pasuk. And that support is the Ramban, the famous Ramban in Parshas Ba'al Oischa, Meshem Rabbeinu Nisim Goin. Right? What was the famous Ramban? Right? The famous Ramban is Rashi brings it. Rashi says like this, right? In the beginning of Parshas Ba'al Oischa. Parshas Ba'al Oischa comes right after Chanukah Samizbeach, after the 12 Nisim brought karbonas every day for the dedication of the Mizbeach, right? So each day and each Novi brought. Which tribe did not bring? Tribe of Levi was not included in the 12 tribes, right? Because Yosef was broken down into Menashe and Ephraim, so tribe of Levi was not included. So the Medrash Gemara says, right after the Chanukah Samizbeach, the 12 tribes, we have the mitzvah of lighting the candle in the Beis HaMikdash is repeated, right? So Rashi says, because Aaron was upset. What was Aaron upset about? Aaron was upset that his tribe didn't participate in such a great thing called Chanukah Samizbeach, dedication of the Mizbeach. So Hashem says, don't worry, you got something better than that. You have the lighting of the menorah. So Ramban says, why is that something better? So he, okay, he's got many mitzvahs. He's why, you know, he's also the one who brings karbonas. The other shvatim did not bring karbonas. So I mean, you can technically either don't tell him, don't be upset. You have nothing to be upset about. You got your job; they got their job. Or if you do have the reason to be upset, so then how did you solve his problem? What did you give him that's like extra? You got him. He had these things extra to begin with. Yeah. So the Ramban answers, no. This is. The point of this is to say that Chanukas and Mizbeach, dedication of the Mizbeach, they brought Karbon and said, ah, from now on, Mizbeach is ready for service, right? And Mizbeach is going to only last up to first base of Mikdash, then again the second base of Mikdash, and then that's it. Is there Mizbeach today? No. But the candle of the menorah, I'm sorry, the menorah that's in the base of Mikdash continues to have its kind relevance. Of implementation, relevance, right, even today. How does it do that? Through the Chanukah menorah that we light. So we're saying, so the Medrash is saying, no, I have iron for you, I have a special thing, that your guys, your descendants, are going to be Kahanim, who are going to dedicate the Mizbeach, and it's going to be connected to the lighting of the Chanukah menorah, right? So we see that there is a hint of the mitzvah of Chanukah within the Torah. Good. And even all of that is when we had prophecy. But now that prophecy ceased, we no longer have prophecy. So we gather all of the sages of Klal Yisrael. And these are going to be the greatest mekubolim, right? These are the two types of Kabbalah. One is called Maaseh Bereishis, the workings of creation. And the other one is called Maaseh Merkava, the workings of the chariot. And they meditate and they hasagosum and they figure out all of these great things and through purification of their mind, and they realize, no, from now on, tefillin should be put on the right hand, not the left hand. Okay, we figured out that this is going to bring Mashiach. Okay, everybody has to switch their hands for tefillin, right? Whatever, that's what they figured out. Let's say, I'm just making stuff up, but let's say that's what they figured out. Or even if they said, no, from now on, Zman Kriya Shema is no longer by 9 a.m. Now Zman Kriya Shema right now is going to be by 12 p.m. Right? Oh, this way everybody's going to get a chance to do it. This is going to bring so much kiruv and it's going to be great and yada yada, right? So, no, loy noiva v'loy nishma lahem. You're not allowed to like what they're saying, not to listen to them at all. Okay? But, right? So, again, this is another kind of attack on the Hasidim, that they through their spirituality, they changed little things here and there. So the Nefesh HaChaim is saying, no, you can't even listen to them. And so, even about a baskol, they said, loy bashamayim hi. It's not bashamayim hi, right? So if a baskol comes out and says, no, this is the way to do it, you say, I'm sorry. We figure it out from our Torah. This is not the way to do it, and it doesn't make a difference. Loi b'shamayim, it's no longer in the heavens, right? So meaning, but loi b'shamayim, meaning, what does it mean loi b'shamayim? He meaning, in, as far as the spiritual worlds are concerned, this is it, right? This is it. No, we don't follow. We follow what we know, based on our written, accepted text. This is what we follow from now on, right? And that's really in halacha. We have this concept, right? If you have, for example, they always talk, they don't always, but they discuss it. If you have a contradiction in Psak between Kabbalah and Halacha, which one do you follow? Halacha. You follow Halacha, right? Halacha trumps Kabbalah, right? In YU, right, there's the Rav, right? The Rav Yoshe Ber Soloveitchik has this book, a sefer called The Halachic Man, right? Which he talks about also the tradition of his family, the Soloveitchik family, where he says that, you know, we have nothing else left besides what's called Arba Amesh of Halacha, the four Amesh of Halacha, and that's what we follow. Regardless, we understand it, don't fully understand it, and this is based kind of on this. The Volozhin family is connected to the Soloveitchik family. Anyways, we continue. V'adayin b'mei Chachmei Talmud. Now again, during the time of the Gemara, they were able to be mechadish, to create new mitzvahs called mitzvahs derabbanan, rabbinical mitzvahs, kishemotzus machmeh Torah. Also, presuming they found support for their ideas in the Torah itself, Goy Neres Chanukah, like Neres Chanukah, Koyaitz, and all. Bechein Ligzer Gzeres, they're also allowed to include new Gzeres, Gzeres that would prevent people from, you know, desecrating Shabbos. So they said, don't do this because maybe you're going to come to this. So they have the power, they had the power during the days of the Talmud to do these things. Right? Kamo Yudches Dover, Ukayoitze. Because she nechtam a Talmud, but once the Talmud, which is technically the oral Torah, but it was written down and it was nechtam, it was sealed, meaning it was completed, the job is done. The Talmud becomes a sort of written text, a kind of a written Torah in a way. Onu ein lono ela lishmor v'lasas k'chol ha'kosu b'Torah k'doshu. We have to guard and do exactly the way it's written in the Torah, shebaksav ubalpe, in the written Torah and the oral Torah. K'chol mishpotam v'chukosam u'bizmanam u'prateyam v'diktokeyam. All the laws, right, and exactly their times, in all of their details and their nuances. Blin tois mehem netiya kol duhu. Without any straying at all. Ukashikaimem Ish Yisrael Karoyan. So when a person, Ish Yisrael, a Jewish man, keeps all of these commandments, all of these halachas properly, Afim lo yichave, now he doesn't have any kavonas, right? He didn't study Arizal, he didn't learn Kabbalah, right? He learned only halacha, but he was so meticulous in his observance to do everything right. Vegam lo yede klal taimem mitzvos, and he has no reason why he's putting on tefillin. No reason, he doesn't know. Doesn't know, but he puts it with all his heart. He comes and he says, this is what Hashem wants. This is what I do. Again, we're not talking about a person who, you know, is an Einstein type of a genius. He just refuses to learn about these things. We're talking about a simple Jew. He doesn't have really the head to sit there or the time to really learn it out. But at the same time, whatever he knows, he implements to the best of his abilities, right? So, im kol zeh niskaimu ha-mitzvos, he all of the mitzvahs he fulfills, v'yusukno lideim kol olamos, and through his doing, I put in an extra word that's not true, v'yusukno al yideim ho olamos, and he is misakin, he is able to fix the world, the spiritual world, as a result. HaKadosh Baruch Hu will take care of what is his, so to speak. V'yisrav b'hem kedusha v'orin, is going to increase kedusha and light in all of those worlds. B'chol mitzvah lefishayto mekor v'inyon, according to each mitzvah that he does in its appropriate time, according to its source, in all of its ideas. V'yutan oizla lekim, and he'll give strength to God, his baruch shmoy, blessed be his name. Right? So he's stressing over here again that many, I think again, another jab at the Hasidim, that many Hasidim concentrated, they went, oh, you got to do mitzvahs with kavona, and you sit there and you say 6 hours for each day, you would meditate until you can do one mitzvah. And he's saying basically, no. That's not the. What's the main part of the mitzvah? The main part of the mitzvah is the action of it. Is the which action? Proper action, correct action, halachic action. You figure out first. You need to know the basics. The basic is figure out exactly that what you're doing is halachically legit, right? Shekein kova aboyre is baruch, because that's what the Creator set up. Tivam shalai lomes. The nature of the whole system is set up. She is now goal yidei maisa odom. That they are controlled by the action of a person. V'chol mitzvah hi ha'olam me'atzma lipol pilosa miyuchad lo. And each mitzvah has a potency, has a power to do what it needs to do in the spiritual realms. It can take care of itself. Your job is to do halachically the right thing. That's your primary purpose in avodas Hashem. Okay, of course, somebody who Hashem merited to really understand the hidden aspects of our Torah, which were left to us, this inheritance, the special heritage that we got left over from the holy ones of the sages of the Talmud, Kagon Rab Shimon Bar Yochai, V'chaveiro V'talmidov, and his colleagues and his students, V'sheshoysin Neimei B'doris Acheroinim, and then from those that we drink their waters from the later generations, for example, Kemoi Harava Kodesh Ishlakim Neiro HaArizal, right, the Holy Arizal, all of these, whatever we understand from them, whatever they taught us, asher ha'iru einenu, they enlightened our eyes, b'ktzas tamei v'kavonais ha'mitzvos, and a little bit of the reasons and the kavonais of the mitzvos, all of those great, wonderful, holy things, who is Rak Kidei Sheizboidin Kol Echad Lefisich Levasagosa, that in order we should be able to contemplate each according to his level, Ad Heichen Magiin Kol Prote Masav, how far reaching all of the various details of our actions, with Diburov and our speech, Machshavoisav and our thoughts, V'chol in Yonav and all the different aspects, B'ho'ilomais, in the spiritual realms, how far reaching our actions, V'akoichos El Yonim V'tachtonim, in the loftiest and the powers above and below. We aspire, and as a result, through that understanding, we will have this incredible inspiration, and we will be stirred up to do and every single mitzvah that we can grab hold of. And then we will direct our service to Creator, blessed be His name. But tachlis adiktuk, in the meticulous detail, a type of avoid of be'ema, with fear of v'yira, another fear of v'ahava atzuma, great love of bikdusha and holiness with tahara salev and purity of heart. While yidei zen, as a result of this, yigram tikunim yoyser gedolei ba'olamis. Of course, we're gonna, as a result of this, accomplish even greater tikkunim, even greater improvements in the spiritual realms, if we are able to be zoicha to these extra kavonas. But me'im hoya mekayim mitzvah b'loy kedusha taharas hakavona. If you were just to do the mitzvah halachically speaking, everything right, but without these kavonas. Of course, kavonas give you more power and they have a greater impact on the world, but that's not the main thing. Amnam, however, ha'ikar, the essential part, b'chol ha'mitzvahs, and all of the commandments, li'ikuva, something that is, li'ikuva meaning if you don't do it, that then you didn't do the service of Hashem, hu prote ha'masa shebehem. Those are the details of the action that's in them. So, solik shar aleph, so that concludes the first gate. So what did we discuss? Let's recap. Right, so these 22 chapters of this first gate.
How many gates total?
There are four gates altogether. Okay, so the first gate told us mainly about the power that the human being has in the world, that his Tzelem Elokim really allows him to control the entire creation, and he does that in three ways, through action, speech, and thought, each one higher than the next. These things are parallel to the three layers of his soul, which is nefesh, ruach, and neshama, right? We talked about, so each of those things that have, in a way, a deeper, like a, so an action, is it one type of a destruction if he does nevera, or an improvement if it tikkun if he does a mitzvah? Speech is another, thought is another. Okay, then we talked about how that same person is parallel. Really, everything that's in, meaning, how does this? Then we talked about the machinery of how this actually takes place, because a person is a microcosm of the creation. Similarly to the Beis Hamikdash, which is the microcosm of the creation of a person, right? So the world, as we said, the world is a big man, and a man is a big world. So everything that we do is directly parallel to some force of creation. So therefore, everything that we do, every little thing, every little detail, has repercussions, and the ripple effect is incredible. And so Hashem, like he brought a pasuk, Hashem judges not only our action, but also when we get our final judgment, the judgment is going to be about not just what we did, but also about those ripple effects. And he's going to show us, okay, these are, you know, you did this little thing here, but this little thing here caused A, B, C, and D, and so you're also going to have to take responsibility for that as well. Okay, but that's for Averis, but same works for mitzvahs. Is the little mitzvahs that we do, that we think it's no big deal, but in reality, we're going to get an amazing amount of schar for all of the ripple effects that we don't even know about. Right? Then he talked about the way that we, the last thing, the last big topic was the way tshuva works in a person, right? How it reconnects him to these four layers. So even the lowest layer, if it's properly connected, is considered to be dovok to Hashem.
Meaning,
right?
That there's no real karis.
Right. Well, there is a karis, but there is a way to fix it because not everything gets cut off, right? So that was an important part, because he was saying is that he brought us a moshul of that glass maker, right? That really a person's neshama is really kind of inside, quote unquote, a Kodesh Baruch Hu's mouth, and so from the place where the Torah really comes from. So when we learn the Torah, we're connecting to our neshama, to the deepest parts, and that also gives us the greatest kedusha possible, and also reconnects to the utmost. And really, we have no direct connection to the neshama, because had we had direct connection to the neshama, we'd be like kind of glowing in the dark. We'd have like absolute memory, perfect recollection. We'll have full understanding of the Torah. But the most we can get to right now is just in like sparks of purity, sparks of inspiration that come down to us. Okay, so that's pretty much what we discussed. And he said one of the things that we mentioned also is Ameni Heshmei Rabbah. When a person says Ameni Heshmei Rabbah, the kavon over there is that the Kedusha should come down through all of those four worlds, and he should reconnect all of the four parts of his neshama. And finally, this is what we mentioned now, conclusion.
Ameni Heshmei Rabbah is like the antidote for Karis.
Right. Correct. That's why it says that if a person even have a 70-year-old Gzar Din, they rip it up, meaning that's his
but
reconnection.
There has to be a
Kavona. He says with all of his strength, and strength means with Kavona. And he says the Kavona is to reconnect all of these four layers of your Neshama back to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, to realign, to reconnect. And that's the power of Ameni Heshmei Rabbah. And then the last thing, the conclusion that we just mentioned was that despite all of this glorious picture of the world and all of the ramifications and all of the effects, and even though our forefathers, you know, each one broke the laws of Torah in each in its own way, because he saw that is what the spirituality required at the time. Once Torah was given, it's printed, it's written, and it's the same for the Talmud. We follow the world, the word of the law, and not necessarily the intention of the law. He said no, but there are times where you're allowed to do it. Meaning, let's say, like there are exceptions to the rule. Again, there's still a concept of Hayroas Shoah, right? Maybe not to the degree of Eliyahu Hanavi. Again, I'm not on the level to decide, but let's say if a person is in concentration camp, let's say, right, and he's going to be there for the rest of his life, I don't know, or he doesn't know if he's ever going to get out, right, and there's everything here is dirty and garbage, and so you're not allowed to learn. Does that mean he should no longer learn for the rest of his life? Or he has to say, listen, time calls for, you know, special times calls for special actions. I'm going to learn Torah. That's still called Hayroas Shoah. That's I'm temporarily suspending this thing in order to accomplish it. Okay, so let's see, what time is it? What time?
11:30.
Okay, so I guess we'll have to stop here, and we'll start Shar Beis next time.